Okay, so our next speaker is Mirta Galesic, and Sid has now started a trend, so Mirta will also introduce herself, but because she might be modest, I will mention that she is not just a professor, but the Cowan Chair in Human Dynamics at SFI, and I will let her then introduce herself for the rest of the way. Mirta?
Hello. I'm really happy to be here and have the opportunity to present my ideas to you. I'm coming from Croatia, if you were wondering. It's a small Balkan Mediterranean country that after end of Balkan Wars is now it's being most famous for being a filming location for Game of Thrones, a series that originated in Santa Fe. Then for the last 8 years, I was a research scientist at the Max Planck Institute for Human Development in Berlin, Germany, and now I'm not modest. I have the honor to be the chair for human social dynamics endowed by legendary George Cowan. I study human sociality, and in my work, I integrate two relatively disconnected approaches to this topic. One in my own discipline, psychology, tends to look at the mind, at the cognitive processes that underlie human social interactions. But they disregard the environment in which these interactions occur, so the structural social networks. In contrast, other disciplines such as sociology and computational social science look at the structure of social environments, the structure of social networks, who is connected with whom, who is particularly influential, and how ideas spread like epidemics among agents that are cognitively at least black boxes and relatively indistinguishable from each other. I find it fruitful to integrate these two approaches and see how mind and environment interact. Because after all, the cognitive processes guide our reactions to our social environments. And I believe that by integrating these two approaches, we can get a fuller picture of human social dynamics and complex social phenomena such as cooperation or spread of beliefs. I have three big questions, if you wish, and numerous smaller. My first big question that I will be talking more about later is belief dynamics, in particular how beliefs spread in societies. And I mean beliefs such as, should we vaccinate our children? Or is global warming happening and what should we do about it? Should we accept gay marriages? Or is violence and terrorism ever an acceptable method of political action? My second question is about origins of human sociality. And in particular, I'm studying how early Pleistocene environment, an interaction between aggravating climate, particular social structure in which our early ancestors lived, and very primitive, early cognitive abilities that we had at that time, might have led to strong interdependence of individuals and the groups in which they lived. And because of that interdependence, it might have been individually beneficial to help others in one's group, for example, through food sharing. And I'm studying whether this could be the first origin of social norms that later on might have led to equality norms, altruistic punishment, and similar norms that have later on led to the large-scale human cooperation development, which is also studied by the faculty associated with the Santa Fe Institute in the late Pleistocene. I studied this through computational models. And my third question is about risk and uncertainty. This is a very applied topic, but very important, I think, in the present day. So we all make various decisions every day, such as how to invest our money, which medical treatments to take, whether we should engage in some pro-environmental behavior or not. And all of these decisions are burdened by a lot of risk and deeper uncertainties that are often difficult to present in a simple, intuitive formats to the general public. And it is a problem of science communication. And I study both how we can design simpler informational formats to present these risks and uncertainties, and also how they depend on the social environment of people and how these social environments can influence what people perceive as risky. As I said, I will talk a bit more about my approach to studying the first topic. Again, as I mentioned, I'm studying it as an interaction of mind and the environment. The structure of social networks and their dynamics have been well studied at the Santa Fe Institute, and I hope to capitalize on this knowledge. Already had some interesting conversations. And I aim to contribute here by enlightening the cognitive part of the network structure. So how do we, what are the cognitive processes that underlie our reactions to our social environments? And here I want to study these cognitive processes in a way that they can be implemented in computational models of social systems. So most psychologists describe processes in the mind in a verbal way, and they do not give precise quantitative predictions. So it's somehow difficult to incorporate them in models that we have here that try to explain and predict particular social environments. And so I'm hoping to, or I'm working on implementing them as simple algorithms that can be implemented in such models. And I'm studying three groups of cognitive processes that are important for understanding social dynamics. One is perception of belief distributions. And through these processes, people try to understand what other people believe in their social environments. For instance, this guy who is surrounded, who has different social contacts, might perceive that some of his social contacts have a red belief, if you wish, and the others have blue belief. And these are just labels, visually attractive colors, that I used to represent any kind of belief. It could be pro or against vaccination, or pro or against global warming, or pro against terrorist actions. Then the second group of processes are social learning strategies. And these processes describe how people adopt their own belief based on the structure of their social environments, on what information they receive from the environments. For instance, this person might copy the majority of, for example, this circle and adopt a blue belief. And the third group of processes describe what happens when there is a conflict between one's own belief and some of the contacts that we are surrounded with. For instance, this person might get a lot of approval from this smaller circle where most people believe blue, but he can be shunned for his beliefs in the larger circle where most people believe red. And now there are at least two ways that he can cope with that. He can revise his own belief to be red, or he can adjust the social contacts and increase his contact with the group that approves of him and decrease the contacts with the group that disapproves. And so this kind of creates a dynamics, a constant revision of the contacts in the network and of own beliefs, which I'd like to study over time. As it develops by means of computational models and perhaps some more elegant models later on. So I will first talk about my approach to studying perception of belief distributions and algorithms that we develop for that purpose. I'll gloss over the social learning strategies and then I have to conclude because I'll run out of time. Perception of belief distributions is an important topic because it studies whether we are able to understand our environments correctly, whether we can see what other people are really thinking and doing, or whether we have certain biases in perceiving these environments, which would prevent us from understanding our own position in the environment and from gaining the best that we can from these environments, from learning and cooperating with others. And in the social circle of social psychologists, the dominant perspective is that people are actually burdened with a number of cognitive and motivational biases that prevent them to see what other people are really thinking and to understand their position and their environments well. In fact, this list of biases is very long. Here is an influential paper that was written a few years ago, or more than a few years ago, that this is just a partial list of many biases that we supposedly suffer from. And the list is long and includes also apparently conflicting biases such as false consensus and false uniqueness, positivity and negativity bias, there is then self-enhancement and self-depreciation. And it's like it's difficult to comprehend how can we be so successful in our cooperation and how can we be such a successful species based on cooperation when we are so bad in understanding each other. I will give an example about false consensus and describe what false consensus is. So this was a phenomenon first described in 1977 by researchers who conducted a study on a liberal arts campus. And they asked their participants to carry this sign, repent, around the campus. And it's a liberal arts campus, so you can imagine that people are not so happy about it, but many of them refused and some agreed. But interestingly, those who agreed to carry the sign thought that more of their fellow students would also agree to carry the sign, and those who disagreed to carry the sign thought that most will disagree and refuse to carry the sign. And this difference, 58 versus 30%, is labeled false consensus. And this has been replicated in many studies in years to follow. It is considered to be an ubiquitous finding in social psychology. Many explanations have been proposed. For example, salience of our own view, selective exposure, improving self-esteem, we feel good about it, to some more sophisticated explanations based on Bayesian updating. However, none of these explanations can explain false uniqueness effects. And this is the opposite effect that has also been shown. We believe that we are in a minority, that only a few people share a point of view. And this has also been shown. So now the question is, can we find a model that explains both false consensus and false uniqueness? My colleagues and I proposed a simple algorithm that, unlike most of the previous also accounts, makes quantitative predictions. It does not include any biases. It's based on exemplar models of memory. And it goes like this. When asked what percent of group X has certain belief, it assumes that people first recall own social contacts that are similar to the group in question. Then they recall those among them who have the belief. And then they just express the answer as a proportion of second over first. So that's a simple algorithm. Let me give a further example. Let's assume that a society has 60% of red believers and 40% of blue believers. But what each person sees are his social contacts, people that he is surrounded with. And because of homophily, which is a ubiquitous property of social environments, where like people socialize with like, it is more likely that a red person will have a few more red believers among his social contacts, and a blue person a few more blue believers than it is in the general population, like this. And now the algorithms would say that when asked what percent of the general population, for example, are red believers, people will recall percentage P of their social contacts that's most similar to the general population. That's their sample. Then recall those who are red believers with certain probability of recall, and then express it as a ratio. Now, how can this explain both false consensus and false uniqueness? Again, the same example presented in a little bit in an even more clear way. Let's look at separately at the answers given by the red believer and by the blue believer about percentage of red in the population. So we start from that population where 60% of people are red believers. And then we assume that there is some level of homophily in the environment, so that red believers have 72% of red people in their environment, and blue believers only 42. Then, because they activate, the people are aware that their social contacts are not the general population, and either automatically or deliberately, they activate the part that's similar to the group that they're asked about, in this case, general population. So now the sample contains a bit closer proportion of red people than it is to the general population than it was among their social contacts. And finally, they give an answer, they forget some, and the answer is the red person gives 62% and the blue believer says 42%, and this is an instance, it looks like false consensus. And note that parameters that we use are this, 90% of social contacts with 90% recall success. Now let's take exactly the same process, but assume that the social environment is different. There is a little bit less homophily in the environment. Now we assume that red people are still surrounded by a little bit more red people than the blue people, but the difference is much smaller. The same process with the same parameters will now lead to something that looks like false uniqueness. Now red person thinks that there are 53% of red people in the environment and blue person 56. So observe that it is an unbiased process, memory sampling process, that can lead to both false consensus and false uniqueness depending on the structure of the social environment. So there's this interesting interaction. To test this further, we conducted a study in the US and Germany. It's a very simple study where we ask people to answer 10 questions for themselves from behaviors such as donating to charity, smoking tobacco, believing in God, or accepting homosexuality. And we asked them to estimate percentage of endorsers among their social contacts. This is what they have. This is the information they have about the environment. And then to estimate this percentage of endorsers in general population. This is where we expect to get false consensus and false uniqueness effects. And indeed, we get both kinds of effects. For some characteristics, we get false consensus. This is the difference in the percentage estimated by people who endorse and those who do not endorse a certain view. And then we get some false uniqueness effects. There is no obvious connection and why some would exhibit false consensus and false uniqueness. And we try to predict those using the simple algorithm I mentioned. So based on the people's social context, we predict their estimates of the general population, and we are able to reproduce this effect. So here on the x-axis, you have the size of false uniqueness and false consensus that I showed before. Here are the predictions of the model. And note, the parameters were fit first for each participant separately and then averaged. And for prediction, we use the average parameters over all individuals and items. So these values were used for all individuals and items. And so the prediction can be much better if you fitted it, but if you fitted individually. But importantly, it predicts which characteristics will show false uniqueness and which false consensus. And similar in Germany, we get a similar thing, except that we missed this one. And then, as I said, this depends on the homophily in the environment. Different characteristics are characterized by different levels of homophily. For some, if we believe something, we are surrounded more often by people who also believe that thing. For others, the environment is more heterogeneous. And if we plot the level of homophily on the x-axis, this is the difference in the social circles of people who endorse something and those who do not endorse. And on the y-axis, you have the size of the false consensus. We see a quite strong correlation where when the level of homophily exceeds a certain point, then we get more false consensus, and otherwise you get false uniqueness in both the United States and Germany. So here I wanted to show that this approach, so we are using a simple algorithm to model belief perceptions, and when interacting with the structure of social environments, we get different effects that are kind of puzzling in the mainstream social psychology. And that's one of the algorithms that I would like to input in this big model of belief dynamics. Another group of algorithms are social learning strategies. And this is very interesting. So these are the algorithms that people might be using to integrate information from their social environments. And here too, I'm taking the approach of making a simple model that gives quantitative predictions and that can be incorporated in a computational model of belief dynamics. Here I'm borrowing on the approach that has been used in my previous institute, Max Planck Institute for Human Development, where we did a lot of research on individual decision making and how rules for making individual decisions can be modeled as algorithms of search, stop, and decision rules. And I take this approach and apply it to the social learning strategies and model them as combinations of different building blocks. You can build many social learning strategies that way. Search rule, stop rule, and decision rule. Search rules described who do we consult and who do we consider when we are thinking of adopting a new product or changing our belief or just when we are observing the environment regarding certain tasks. We can consult our kin, or we can consult successful people that we see around ourselves, or people who we meet frequently. And there are individual differences. So we all differ in a way in which we sample, if you wish, our social environment. Some people will consult family, some will consult successful people. And this also depends on the task that we are facing, on the kind of belief. Medical decision is different than a financial or some intimate private decision. The stopping rule describes when do we stop. Do we stop after one person, several people, or after a certain threshold in evidence for one or the other belief is reached? And again, we differ in this. Some consult one friend or no friends, some consult many friends. And finally, there is the decision rule, and this determines how we make a decision based on the sample that we collected in the first two steps. Decision rules have been studied a lot in the animal learning literature and in models studying cultural evolution. And these are population genetic models, typically, which are mathematically tractable and therefore need to be kept simple. And they describe really nicely how these strategies can evolve over time. But for tractability, they need to often disregard these messy parts, how the information is sampled. And if they are taken into account, they're taken into account for a parameter, for example, weak or strong conformity. But I think that to predict a real-world situation, how a belief will spread in a particular society, we need to take into account all these messy details here as well. And so back to my big overview slide. My approach to studying belief dynamics is to incorporate these simple cognitive algorithms in the kind of what we know about the structure and the dynamics of social networks and see whether we can predict something real, how a new belief will spread in a particular society. Note that the steps of these algorithms can be actually measured. So we can, in a given society, we can ask people, so who do you consult? After how many people do you stop? How do you make a decision? And we can also, based on the structure of their social contact, we can predict how they observe the broader society. And so we can kind of limit the number of free parameters, so this is the hope of this, so if you have something that's precise, that is measurable and related to the real situation rather than fitted post hoc. And my hope is to be able to, as I said, predict spread of beliefs, and my ultimate goal is to be able to predict when conflicts occur. So growing up on Balkans during the time of war, it's fascinating how quickly can societies break and mend again. And models such as this might be helpful to try to predict such things. When will conflict occur and when they will not occur? So it's a grand, you know, goal, but one have to have dreams. So, thanks.
Stop decision part at the end for obvious reasons. I wonder whether there's any commitment to that order, because it seems to me that if you are committed to a particular decision role, it will impact on how much searching you need to do and when you would stop. For instance, if you're copying the majority, you need to sample a large number of individuals, whereas if you're copying the best, then you might only need to stop after a single individual once you've identified that. So is the order critical here?
Yes, so definitely the stop rule will determine which decision rule can be used. So if there is only one person, then you cannot copy the majority. That's true.
I was thinking in the context of some social phenomenon that we might consider bad, say dropping out of high school. So if you saw a community of students where there was a high percentage of dropping out of high school, and you were going to try and do some sort of social intervention to change that, what does this research suggest people should do?
So my research suggests that people are quite good in understanding their immediate social environments. They know who does what and who believes what quite well. And the research suggests the best way to kind of try to change people's minds is not to give them rational reasons why it would be good to stay in school, but to give more examples of people who successfully finish school, to kind of introduce good examples in the social environment with which they can recall and use when they are making their own decisions. Basically, yeah.
Thanks, very interesting talk.
I was wondering how in empirical work you would distinguish, you would sort of solve this problem, this reflection problem, that people who are in the similar social environment also share a particular socioeconomic background, and so not everything is transmitted, not everything is can be intervened with, because some of it just reflects what is in those areas. And it's very hard, at least in economics, to separate out those two, which is why a lot of the stuff which is seen as, you know, these networks of transmission of obesity and smoking and all that stuff is, we don't believe that stuff very much.
Mm-hmm. It's difficult to determine what's the cause and what's the consequence, of course.
Well, there are two phenomena going on at the same time. One is that there's certainly some room for transmission of sort of ideas and beliefs and so forth, but then there's another which is of the fact that, you know, they're all reflecting an external factor, which is a socioeconomic context or phenomena. Mm-hmm. And simply noticing clustering doesn't necessarily explain that it's because of the transmission.
Yeah, so my approach to this problem is to follow societies over time and to see how, given a particular initial state, which may have occurred in different ways, and I cannot discern how the initial state occurred, but given the initial state and the heuristics, if you wish, rules people use to integrate information from the social environment, how they change over time. So my focus is on the dynamics of the system. So once I know what happened, how the situation is now, I'm trying to predict what's going to happen next. But of course, you're right. The real life is super messy. So I guess the first, after building computational models, my first goal would be to make more controlled experiments where we create artificial societies, relatively artificial, so real people, but that are composed for this purpose, and then where we implant a certain belief and see how it spreads given the rules that people are using, which may be given to them or measured. And then we can see in this more closed environment how this spreads, and then ideally later on try to investigate more messy real-world situations. But
yeah, have you looked at the networks of influence to see what their structure is, and in particular whether I would expect there to be asymmetries, that just because A pays attention to B doesn't mean B pays attention to A, but are they small world networks? What do they look like?
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Have you looked, what you look at, you looked at how many people individuals pay attention to.
Mm-hmm.
But one could also construct a graph, a network of influence to see who influences whom, and is it more likely that if I'm influenced by A, I'm also I would also expect asymmetries in there, that certain people are nodal and pay less attention to.
Yeah. So my general approach is keep things simple and see how much you can explain by keeping things simple. So far I was basically operationalizing influence by frequency of contact. So those who are more, the people that you are in a more frequent contact with were assumed to have more influence. But as we know, it's not so simple. And you're right. But as I said, again, my approach is to keep it very simple, maybe operationalize the frequency of contact, see how far we can go, and then introduce further complications if needed. And this was the approach that we took for explaining this fast uniqueness and other biases. Just taking a super simple model without any further assumptions, and just see how far we can go. And of course, maybe people really feel good when they believe that other people think like them or that they are unique. It might be, but we cover the basis with a simple thing. But, yeah.
Okay, I think I'm going to take the chair's prerogative and ask the last question.
Okay.
It seems to me that one of the biggest advances in social psychology in the last few decades has been to really drive home in a data-driven way just how poor humans are at understanding or reading the thoughts and motivations of other people.
Yeah.
And it seemed to me that the question that crystallized in my mind as you were talking, the big question is, how is it that we are so bad at doing this, and yet cooperation works so well? And that strikes me as an extremely interesting question that is perfect for SFI. And in your talk, you showed a lot of data sort of supporting this, and I guess, you know, there's all kinds of foundational work, Kahneman and Tversky and others on this kind of thing. My question is, how does one go from here to there? Do you see what kinds of perhaps modeling techniques can one use that we use at SFI that can be used to try to gain some headway into this question, because that seems to me to be a really important project for SFI.
So it's a messy thing. So the social system. So my first approach will be to use agent-based models, mm-hmm. but you know you can model everything with agent-based models, and how you tweak them it matters. So I intend to combine that with my experience in collecting empirical data, survey data, experimental data to fix the parameters, if you wish, to kind of to know, you know, okay, these people are using these decision rules, so we'll put those and not try to experiment with all of. And so it would be, the first would be computational models guided by empirical data. And later on, and we can see whether we can make a more beautiful model where we connect with a beautiful theoretical mathematical work that's done on networks and network dynamics at SFI, and see whether we can describe some of these seemingly messy cognitive processes in a more, in a better way, and kind of have some analytical predictions. That would be ideal.
Thanks. Hopefully it's not a random walk. Well. Okay, let's thank our speaker again.
Thank